What's going on, everyone? Welcome back to the spot. We kick back and react to all kind of different things. All right, so what we got going on today? Well, Film Theory has dropped an interesting one. Inside Out Analog Horror Gets Dark. All right, so before we begin this, when I clicked on this video, it came up with a disclaimer, so I'm not repeating it word for word. Basically, it has some disturbing images, apparently. And it's going to address suicide. It's going to have some images, apparently, from what the disclaimer said. So, same disclaimer up here. If you don't want to see that, then go ahead and click off this video. But otherwise, you have been warned. All right. Anyway, these analog horrors are always really interesting. And Inside Out is a movie that I enjoyed. I haven't seen the second one. My wife and kid have, but I haven't seen it. I'm waiting for it to come out the theaters on video. I think it probably has already. I need to check. Anyway, let's go ahead and get into this. Inside Out, Analog Horror Gets Dark. Let's see where they're going with this. Let's go.
It's spooky season once again, and you know what that means? It's time to talk about Inside Out. Wait, Inside Out? Hello, Internet. Welcome to Film Theory, the show that just wants to make sure that you're doing okay. So, now that we're several months out from the release of Inside Out 2, it's finally hit Disney Plus, so you can cry your heart out over and over and over again. But believe it or
not... Okay, it's out. I'll be watching 2 very soon. I'm not really worried about spoilers, but because my wife already told me like all about the movie, because they loved it so much. But let's go.
That's not actually why I wanted to talk about it today. No, instead, I want to talk about Inside Out because of a particular video that came across my YouTube feed that surprised me. An Inside Out analog horror series. Wait, what? Yeah, you heard that right. The Inside Out tapes is an analog horror series created by Venezuelan animator L30K72.
I'm not really surprised that somebody did that because if you think about it, you know, the show is huge. I've seen mobile games. I've seen all kinds of different stuff with the Inside Out theme on it. So yeah, I feel like this was about to happen. Basically.
I'm just gonna call him L30 for short. It takes us back into the mind of Riley Anderson, the girl from the Pixar films, and the emotions piloting her like a mech suit. Joy, sadness, fear, anger, disgust, anxiety, ennui, embarrassment, and envy. But something isn't quite right here. Alongside the emotions that we know and love, there's something else in Riley's head, a mysterious new entity that has taken control at Riley HQ. And while every emotion in the movies wants the best for Riley, this being... wants the worst for her. It fills her head with false memories and dark thoughts, and turns many of the emotions into monstrous reflections of themselves. Now, this might sound like it could be a lighthearted, spooky time, something akin to The Nightmare Before Christmas or Goosebumps, but, well, it's not. I'm going to be real with you. The Inside Out tapes is one of the darkest subjects we've ever covered on the channel. This isn't a joke, it isn't a bit. While this analog horror uses the bright, colorful characters from Inside Out, it covers heavy topics like trauma, mental health, and self-harm. By the end, it's a story worth telling, and a story worth hearing, but no shame if this one isn't for you theorists. And if at any point you feel like the subject matter we're covering today affects you, we've left resources and phone lines from around the world in the description that can offer you help. But if you stick around for this one, the Inside Out tapes show us a monstrous entity wreaking-
And I'm putting the same information down at the, bottom description of this reaction video as well, okay?
Havoc on Riley's sanity, and figuring out what this entity is will be the key to helping Riley and her emotions stop it. Get ready, loyal theorists. This one's going to get real. So let's go over what we actually see happen in the series, shall we? The story starts with a slideshow telling us that Riley's been really going through it. She keeps reliving a very unhappy memory in her head over and over, one where she's in the back of a car before the car seems to hit something. Joy has taken it upon herself to help Riley suppress this corrupt memory, but something else is also living inside of Riley's head. Some strange, dark entity that sneaks up on and ambushes Joy. It starts to change Joy, physically morphing her into straight-up nightmare fuel before she goes on a rampage throughout Riley's head. The other emotions try to contain this corrupted Joy, but fail. Sadness and anger are killed, while disgust, envy, and embarrassment are infected with whatever has overtaken Joy. Fear, ennui, and anxiety manage to escape, though the infected emotions chase after them. Now, with no one to stop it, this entity plants a new idea inside Riley's head, taking her own life.
Oh, my dear Riley, you know very well that without them you are nothing. It's time to make some changes time to drop everything. It's time to...
But thankfully, she's saved by her mother at the last second. More or less, that's the broad strokes of the story we have for the Inside Out tapes so far. But there are so many unanswered questions left by this series. Will Riley be okay?
Wait, so far, so it's an ongoing series? Wow. Okay.
Okay, what is this entity? What will happen to the emotions? Well, let's try to answer all of those, starting with the event that got this downward spiral started, the accident. As I mentioned earlier, we see flashes of this corrupt memory in the story, during which we see parts of a car crash that has taken a huge toll on Riley's psyche. My first thought was that maybe one or both of Riley's parents died in the crash, causing the troubles now inside of Riley's head. We hear the entity tell Riley,
"Oh, my dear Riley.
This seems to me like Riley's subconscious trauma reminding her that her parents are dead and playing on a fear that she's nothing without them. But this isn't the case because of one major fact. We know that both of her parents are alive. Obviously, we see her mom rush in and save her at the end, and she tells Riley that she's already called her dad and he's on his way. Now, you might interpret this as something symbolic, the spirit of her mother coming in to comfort her at the end, but I don't believe that's the case. We see her physically interact with the door when she kicks it down, and quote, "your father is on his way," isn't language a spirit would use in this sort of situation. I would imagine it would be something closer to, "your father is waiting." I think we're supposed to take these events at face value. Her parents are alive, but strangely, that isn't clear to Riley. Yeah, when her mom saves her, Riley seems very confused, asking her, "Mom, but you were, what happened to the accident? What about Dad? Is he okay?" Riley thinks that both of her parents died, when that isn't the case. There's a clear disconnect between what Riley thinks happened and what actually happened. Her head's full of memories that didn't happen, something we actually see explicitly shortly afterward as fear, anxiety, and on we get to the back of Riley's mind. They come across a pile of what they call false thoughts, memories of things that never occurred. And if we look back at what we see of the memory of the accident, we can confirm that this is one of those false memories. Right before the crash, we see the silhouette of some monstrous being right outside of the car. That is a manifestation of this weird entity inside of this false memory, because he's the reason Riley thinks it's real in the first place. This entire car crash is a false memory. There was no accident. So that then begs the question, what the heck even is this entity? Like, this thing is weird, right? We see it creating these false memories, infecting other emotions, and it can take control of Riley like the emotions can. Well, first off, it might be easier to start out with what this entity isn't. Like, it's clearly not an emotion like the others are. It's not a personification of a normal part of the emotional spectrum. Joy straight up says this, and it also lines up with the fact that it wants to hurt Riley. Think about it. One of the things that has been very consistent about the Inside Out franchise is that all of the emotions only want what's best for Riley, even if they disagree on what that is. That is just straight up not what we see here from this entity. Secondly, we also know that this entity probably isn't trauma. That was actually my first thought going into the series, that this was sort of a representative of trauma corrupting the emotions. Studies have shown that trauma can negatively impact someone's psychology and emotions, so it all fits, except for the fact that the accident that caused the trauma wasn't real. It was a false memory. And even if there was some traumatic car crash at some point in Riley's past, when Joy is first looking into the false memories, she says that the entity's influence has been here for months, since before the accident. So, this entity can't be the result of trauma on the brain from that car crash. It's something else, something underlying. So, what is it? Well, we get a big hint from the title of this video. Yeah, okay, if that made no sense, fair. It's just a random assortment of letters. Or is it? Yeah, if you've been watching Theorist long enough...
Oh man, I miss Vsauce. They haven't uploaded on their main channel in so long. But that was funny.
You know that random letters like this aren't actually often all that random, and this string of letters is actually a good old Caesar cipher. If you take each letter in the title and wind it back one letter in the alphabet, it instead reads psicosis, the Spanish word for psychosis. And to really drive this home, there's also a QR code that briefly flashes on screen in a blink and you miss it moment, leading you to a medical site describing the condition. Okay then, what is psychosis? Well, while the media often throws around words like psychotic willy-nilly, they probably shouldn't. According to MedlinePlus.gov, psychosis is a condition where a person has difficulty telling what's real from what isn't. They may have false beliefs about what's happening around them, who people are, or in some cases, they may even hallucinate, seeing or hearing things that aren't actually there. A lot of the time, this condition doesn't just come out of
Yeah, they really need to stop throwing the phrase out there, because I was thinking that, but I didn't know what phrase to call it. So I was like, okay, so it's psychosis. So I was like, this sounds like, you know, this people who just be coming up with stuff in their head that's not reality and it's messing with them. So yeah, psychosis, that's what it is.
Nowhere. It can be the result of brain tumors, diseases like Parkinson's or dementia, or serious psychiatric disorders. Think things like schizophrenia or bipolar disorder. Given what we see in the Inside Out tapes, I believe Riley is suffering from one or more of these psychiatric disorders, and specifically bipolar disorder. Why? Well, several of the symptoms line up, and one of the teasers L30 made for the series was straight up called bipolar, so seems cut and dry. Generally speaking, bipolar disorder isn't just one thing. Instead, it's an entire spectrum. According to the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, or DSM, created by the American Psychiatric Association, bipolar disorder has two main extremes. The first is a manic or hypomanic episode. Basically, a person's emotions will be elevated, their thoughts will constantly be racing, their mind and feelings are just kicked into overdrive. And mapping this onto the Inside Out tapes, this really reflects what we see happen to the infected emotions, doesn't it? They become more energetic, like they're kicked into overdrive. Corrupted joy isn't even necessarily joy anymore, she's mania. On the other extreme, someone with bipolar disorder may often pair manic episodes with what are known as major depressive episodes. This is pretty much exactly what it sounds like, days where someone can be in a depressed mood, with a lack of interest in pretty much anything. This is often paired with feelings of worthlessness, guilt, and recurring thoughts of death. The shots we see of Riley outside of her head really play into this, but even what happens inside of her head fits too. Oftentimes, these depressive episodes are characterized by fear of the unknown, increased anxiety, or a complete loss of interest in things that once made you happy. Fear, anxiety, and ennui, exactly the emotions that would represent these depressive episodes. Actually, ennui taking center stage as a major character in this story really stuck out to me, because I've often heard depression described not as an intense sadness, but instead a lack of any emotion at all. In this universe, that's basically what ennui represents. So, okay, Riley is suffering from a psychosis brought on by bipolar disorder. The entity inside of her head is a manifestation of that psychosis, and it's having a negative impact on her mental health and emotional state. So now, I have to ask, what are the next steps here for Riley? What's next for the emotions inside of her head? Well, it's complicated. Psychology is not easy, and the human brain with all of its quirks is complex. Things aren't black and white, and even if she's gotten professional help, it might not be the exact help she needed. Now, don't get me wrong, seeking a professional like a doctor or a psychiatrist is absolutely something you should do if you're struggling with these sorts of mental health issues. I cannot encourage that enough. Things can just get difficult when these professionals are trying to figure out what type of help to provide. Let's take a look at a physical problem, like COVID, for example, and compare it to a psychological one. Two people can have COVID but show completely different symptoms, and a doctor might not know that they both have the same disease until they test for it. At that point, they can prescribe the correct medications and treatments. But what if making a positive diagnosis wasn't as easy as a quick test? Imagine trying to diagnose someone with COVID only from their symptoms. Do they have COVID, the flu, malaria?
Exactly. That's the biggest difference. You can't do a blood test for these particular issues, which makes it that much more difficult. Definitely seek help, but understand that it's going to be a process for them to be able to figure out exactly the kind of help that you need. Just like you just said here. I always say that to people whenever they ask me about it. Always, you know, understand it's going to be a process. You might, you know, need to see more than one or like change psychiatrists sometimes and things like that. But all in all, don't give up. Don't give up, because they are there to help, and it is going to take time because there's limitations, you know. Can't do a blood test about it.
All have similar symptoms, and it might be hard to tell just from those symptoms alone. Well, in the world of psychology, the symptoms are all they have to deal with. And while the symptoms for multiple psychological disorders may be similar, the potential treatments could be radically different. Two people with the same diagnosis might show completely different symptoms but get the same treatment, while two people with the exact same symptoms might be prescribed completely different treatments to manage their symptoms. It's incredibly complicated, and this might be exactly what's happening in Riley's case, because there's another psychiatric disorder that also fits her symptoms, schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is a mental disorder characterized by five main symptoms, though only two are necessary for a diagnosis. These are delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, catatonic behavior, and decreased ability to express emotions and do activities. Depending on how you count it, Riley is showing up to four of these symptoms: delusions, hallucinations, catatonic behavior, and a decreased ability to express emotions. That last symptom is shown by the death of her more extreme emotions like sadness, anger, and joy. Riley may be having difficulty expressing those emotions because, in her head, they're not around to help guide her. Thankfully for Riley, whether she has bipolar disorder or schizophrenia, her potential treatment plan is going to be the same: antipsychotic medication. These are drugs meant to, well, treat psychosis, and we actually see exactly which one Riley has been prescribed. At the start of episode 2, we see a prescription box labeled quetiapina, the Spanish word for quetiapine, an antipsychotic approved for the treatment of schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. There are also some other pill bottles here too, likely drugs commonly prescribed with antipsychotics like antidepressants or mood stabilizers. So, problem solved, right? Well, sadly, no. When Riley's mother comes in and saves her, she notices that Riley hasn't taken her medication. But why? Well, again, it's complicated. Just as a heads up, this is where we're going to really be getting into some of the really tough stuff.
I've seen that firsthand. People who refuse to take their medication and go on these end up having certain episodes because of it. And it's like, take your medication, but at the same time, it might be things about like the side effects of the medication that they don't like or something like that. Or they might get it in their head that, you know, they think the medication is there to hurt them or something like that. It's so many different factors that can really like get in the way. You would think, oh, just take the medication, you'll be fine, but it's really not that cut and dry. So let's see. It's about to get really dark here, so let's see where this goes.
Just like getting a diagnosis can sometimes be really difficult or complicated, treatment for these sorts of disorders can also be hard. Some drugs just aren't effective for certain people, and doctors won't know whether or not they work for a patient until they try them. Additionally, a lot of these sorts of medications can come with a whole host of side effects, both physical and mental.
Yeah, side effects, but then also we just say that right there, sometimes ineffective. Sometimes our immune system picks up on certain medications and, you know, our immune system, which thinks it's helping us because it's meant to block any foreign substances that it thinks might harm our physical body, but it's not helping us because it's stopping what the medication is really supposed to do, you know? So it's like our immune system could sometimes be a double-edged sword on that. Whew!
Potentially making the problem worse. In fact, if you look at Seroquel, a brand name version of the drug Riley is taking, you can find warnings that the drug may cause an increased risk of self-harm in children and adolescents. Young people just like Riley. And that's the takeaway here. Riley's problems are real. Like so many other people, she is clearly struggling with a mental disorder that is negatively affecting her emotions, whether that be schizophrenia or bipolar disorder or something else. But sadly, the treatment she is currently getting just isn't working for her. Either it's not helping to manage her symptoms, or it's presenting new and worse symptoms. Thankfully, there is a path forward here for Riley, just like there would be for anyone else suffering from these disorders. First off, it's good news that Riley's been diagnosed early enough to get treatment, since those with undiagnosed and untreated psychotic disorders can have a shorter than average lifespan. They've caught it early, and they can try multiple different methods to treat it if necessary. Secondly, she can reach out to her doctor, and they can talk about her current treatment. They can work together to try to find out why it's not working and find a solution. Trying different dosages, switching medications, or finding alternative treatments and therapy. But thirdly, and most importantly, we know that Riley has a good support structure in her parents, who clearly care about her safety and well-being enough that they literally drop everything to get her through this dark episode. With a good support structure, good doctors, and time, Riley will eventually find the right balance of medication, therapy, and whatever else resolve she needs to not only survive the demon she's living with, but also to thrive. To move forward into a happier, healthier person, and this will help her emotions too. Emotional blunting, or numbness, is a common side effect of these mental disorders, as well as the resulting depression and trauma, but it isn't permanent. Even though characters like anger, sadness, and joy have died in the Inside Out tapes, they can come back once Riley finds treatments that work for her. When she finds new ways to cope and move forward with her struggles, there's hope for Riley and all of her emotions, just like there's hope for anyone struggling with these same issues. Really, this is why I wanted to talk about the Inside Out tapes today. We have come a long way as a society when it comes to mental health, talking about these disorders and doing our best to make sure people get the help that they need. And series like the Inside Out tapes, they help educate more people. They help spread the word about this information. And really, now I want to talk directly to you. If you're struggling with the same sorts of mental health problems that Riley does in this series, I promise that you are not alone. There are people who care, and there is help out there. And once again, we've left resources from around the world in the description that you can call if you need it. And that, my friends, isn't a theory, it's a fact. And cut. Next time on Film Theory.
What Miles is feeling here and everything he's confronting, Shadow Demon and all, are real things that can happen in the real world. And what's even worse for Miles? This can be deadly, with the danger only amplified by Miles' very own superpowers.
All right. Did that one already drop? If so, it's going to be the next one coming very soon. All right, but yeah, that was a great episode. Got to applaud it. I love seeing episodes, or, you know, just episodes in general where they're out there really trying to help people. All the theories are fun, but these are truly important when we see these drop. Anyway, like I said, I'm putting the same help resources that they listed down in the description down here, so you don't have to go all the way back. But definitely check out the main video. Like it, support it. I love all the theory channels. And before you go, be sure to like this video, hit that subscribe button. And as always, I'll see y'all on the next one. So till next time, we're out of here. So as always, on to the next one.